Okay, everybody, here we are, man. Back again. This is Black Sabbath, Mob Rules, Side 2. Side 2 and possibly the review attached to the back end of it. We'll see if YouTube accepts it. If not, I'll just split the review from Side 2 and we can meet in the review and share our thoughts and things. So, man, yo, Side 1 was excellent. I really enjoyed it. The songs were really, really powerful. The delivery of Ronnie James Dio really, really makes this album so far really, really something. And of course, the musicianship of Black Sabbath, it's a great pairing off, let me tell you. Fantastic pairing. So, man, let's check this out. This is Side 2 of Mob Rules. Black Sabbath, Mob Rules, Side 2. Let's get it.
Song.
great vocals, excellent musicianship, powerful. That was excellent. That was very good.
I'm leaving.
Jackson. Paralyzed, can't move. Well, all right, man. So that is side two of The Mob Rules. Even though The Mob Rules is the strong commercial hit on this album, and rightly so, it's a great song. I really like side two, not much more, but those four tracks are really powerful, really intentional, emotional content. It's driven by strong lyrics, and the musicianship really matches the intensity of the lyrics. It's just a very strong, compelling side. Side two is it for me on this album, man. Side one was great. Side two, in my opinion, is a little bit better, just for the intensity of it all, the delivery of it all, the driving delivery of it all, the pairing of Ronnie's incredible intense vocals and with the musicianship. It's wow, it's intense, and I really like it, man. Side two definitely is the shit for me. But overall, the whole album is great, man. It's an excellent album, great musicianship, and as I'm gonna keep saying, an excellent pairing between the musicianship of Black Sabbath and the intense vocals of Ronnie James Dio. You can't miss, man. You just can't miss. This is the end of side two, man. So I'm going to cut this off. Well, I'm not going to cut this off. I'm going to carry on into the review. And if it doesn't upload onto YouTube, if it gets blocked, then I'm going to cut them in half. So on to the review, man. That was excellent. So I'm just going to Mob Rules Wikipedia page here, man. Yeah, lots of decent information, definitely. Yeah, let's jump around a bit, read a couple of paragraphs, man. All right, so Mob Rules. Mob Rules is the 10th studio album by English heavy metal band Black Sabbath, released in November of 81. It followed 1980's Heaven and Hell, and it was the second and last Black Sabbath studio album to feature lead vocalist Ronnie James Dio until the 1992 album Dehumanizer. Produced and engineered by Martin Birch, the album received an expanded edition release in 2010. Okay, let's scroll down to recording. Mob Rules was the first Sabbath album to feature Vinny Appice on drums, who had replaced original member Bill Ward in the middle of the Heaven and Hell tour. So, who is Vinny Appice in relations to Carmine Appice? Is he a brother? Is he a son? Who is he? Is he actually related to Carmine Appice? I'm guessing that he is. Asked by Joe Matera in 2007 if working with a new drummer was jarring after so many years, bassist and lyricist Geezer Butler replied, quote, "No, because Vinny was a big fan of the band and loved Bill's playing. Bill was one of his favorite drummers, and so he knew all his parts and my bass parts, and he adjusted accordingly to everybody in the band. He was brilliant. He came in and totally filled in Bill's shoes," unquote. Why did Bill depart, by the way? I don't know the story behind that. I know why Ozzy left. I don't know why Bill left. In an interview for the concert film Neon Nights, 30 Years of Heaven and Hell, Butler cites, quote, "The Sign of the Southern Cross" as his favorite Mob Rules track because it gave me a chance to experiment with some bass effects. The album was the last time the band worked with producer and engineer Martin Birch, who went on to work with Iron Maiden until his retirement in 1992. Iommi explained to Guitar World in 92, quote, "We were all going through a lot of problems at that time, most of it related to drugs. Even the producer, Martin Birch, was having drug problems, and it hurt the sound of that record. Once that happens to your producer, you're really screwed," unquote. Tough times. Mob Rules would be singer Ronnie James Dio's second and final studio recording with Black Sabbath until the Mob Rules era lineup reunited for the 1992 Dehumanizer. The seeds of discontent appeared to have sprouted when Dio was offered a solo deal by Warner Brothers, with Iommi stating in his memoir, quote, "After the Heaven and Hell record became such a great success, Warner Brothers extended the contract at the same time, offering Ronnie a solo deal. That felt a bit odd to us because we were a band and we didn't want to separate anybody." Dio confided in an interview on the Neon Nights 30 Years of Heaven and Hell DVD that the recording of Mob Rules was far more difficult for him than Heaven and Hell because, quote, "We approached the writing very much differently than the first one. Geezer had gone, so we wrote in a very controlled environment in a living room with little amplifiers." And I don't know why Geezer departed. Let me know why Geezer left. "And with Mob Rules, we hired a studio, turned up as loud as possible, and smashed through it all. So it made for a different kind of an attitude." Unquote. Iommi reflected to Guitar World in 92, "Mob Rules was a confusing album for us. We started writing songs differently for some reason and ended up not using a lot of really great material. That lineup was really great, and the whole thing fell apart for very silly reasons. We were all acting like children. The major problem, noted by Mick Wall in his book, Black Sabbath Symptoms of the Universe, was that the balance of power within the band had shifted. With Bill and Ozzy happy to leave the heavy lifting to Tony and Geezer in terms of songwriting, coming into the studio only when they were called, even as their flair deserted them over the final Dismay Ozzy era albums, at least everybody knew where they stood. Now though, the creative chemistry had shifted." Unquote. Yeah, very interesting. The structure of writing. And I am guessing that Geezer wrote in a very, unanchored style. It was just kind of very, very out there. Whereas it seems like maybe Ronnie's writing is a little bit more structured. Yeah, let's come in, let's sit down, let's do some focusing. And maybe Geezer doesn't write like that. Is that, am I guessing? If you know your Black Sabbath history, let me know. But Tony says, "I still like that album," he reflected in 97. Okay, release and reception. Let's go down to that. Mob Rules was released on the 4th of November in 81 to mixed reviews. In the US it went gold, and in the UK it reached the top 20 and spawned two chart singles, the title track and Turn Up the Night. AllMusic's Greg Prado calls the album underrated and enthuses that Mob Rules was given a much punchier in-your-face mix by Birch, who seemed to be re-energized after his work on new wave of British heavy metal upstarts Iron Maiden's killer album. Essentially, Mob Rules is a magnificent record, with the only serious problem being the sequencing of the material, which mirrors Heaven and Hell's almost to a T. Iommi acknowledged this common criticism in his memoir, admitting that he was frustrated at being accused of making Heaven and Hell Part 2, and speculating that the band would have been criticized regardless of their approach. Appraising the album in February of 86, Rolling Stone writer J.D. Constantine trashed Mob Rules. Profiling the album in 2008, Brian Reisman noted, "Even with Dio bringing in more fantasy-based lyrics and moving the group away from seemingly satanic verses, the title track to Mob Rules, not to mention its menacing cover, could easily imply a call to anarchy. But beyond the snarling guitars and vocals, it's actually a cautionary tale against mindless mayhem." Yeah, Black Sabbath lyrics have a lot of warning. Warning. Change this or dire consequences will befall you. That is kind of like an underlying current of a lot of Black Sabbath songs. So it's not that they are heralding evil and praising demons and all of this nonsense. It is issuing warning. And I like that undercurrent of their the messages in their music. They're very, very aware of things going on in the world on different sides, you know? So that is my reaction and my review of Mob Rules. I like the album personally. I can see that it could be mixed, especially if now you're comparing it to their previous successes. Maybe you're comparing Dio to Ozzy, what have you. So I imagine that there will be a lot of mixed points of view. But overall, as just a very, very green person looking and wading into the pool of rock and roll, I like this album very good. I'm just going by how it sounds to me and how it makes me feel. It makes me feel good, inspired. I admire the musicianship. The vocals is fantastic. I'm impressed all around. Yeah, you know, I'm sure it isn't their best, but by far, it's much, much better than I imagine a lot of music at the time. So, hey man, you know, I'm not a critic, and I don't have intense music knowledge, but I know what sounds good to me, and this sounds good to me. This is a damn fine album. I don't know, where would I rate it? If I'm gonna rate it, I guess I'd have to compare it to previous albums, which is unfair in a way, but I would give it a 4.5 out of 5. What would you rate it? Where would you go with it? And maybe you've got an expert opinion. Maybe you've just got a general admiration for rock and you've got a decent ear. Where would you rate it? Let me know. And if you have negative things to say about it, tell me why. Break it down for me. Educate me and tell me why. All right, man. So that is the conclusion of my reaction and the conclusion of my Unholy Trinity weekend, and I'll probably do another one because, you know, it'll be a lot easier for me because the weekends start with Led Zeppelin, and so, you know, depending on timing and what I've got going on, whatever, I can maybe free up some space and throw in another couple of album reactions, you know, just and have another Unholy Trinity weekend and just kind of like maybe follow that pattern for the next little whatever. So that way I'm going to stay on top of my Deep Purple and my Black Sabbath, you know, reactions, and I'll drop the ball on it. I've been thinking about that. So that's why you're seeing this Unholy Trinity kind of experimentation. Let me know what you think about that. I think I should probably try to follow a pattern. When I follow patterns, I seem to stay on point, you know, unless something happens, like with Kenny Rogers passing, you know, everything drops. And of course, I do tributes to our heroes who have passed. But yeah, that's what I'm thinking of doing going forward. So let me know what you think about that. Anyways, man, I'm going to bounce. So thank you very much for joining me. Hope you enjoyed my Unholy Trinity weekend. And I'm definitely looking to do more. ZZ Top, their 7th studio album is up for tomorrow, and I'll try and squeeze in a complimentary quad. I'm a little bit behind, so I'll get on that as well. But anyway, man, you guys have yourselves a good week. Stay safe out there. Remember to keep mindful about your social distancing. It's very, very important, man. Isolate as much as you can. Keep your ass home, all right? Anyway, have a good one, and I'll catch you later. Peace.